गुड मॉर्निंग क्लास।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
टिल नाउ वी हाउ मेनी सीपीयू शेड्यूलिंग एल्गोरिथम वी हैव स्टडीड? कैन एनीवन टेल मी हाउ मेनी सीपीयू शेड्यूलिंग एल्गोरिथम वी हैव सीन टिल नाउ? प्लीज टेल मी हाउ मेनी सीपीयू शेड्यूलिंग एल्गोरिथम वी हैव लर्न टिल नाउ? Can anyone tell me? Chitranshu is saying two. Very good. Can you name those? Please name. Provide the name of those CPU scheduling algorithm. Please write your answer in the chat box. If you want to speak, you can unmute yourself and tell me. Prince Sharma is saying FCFS and round robin. One thing here I would like to tell you all of you that. To talk in shortcut, to write in shortcut, to write in abbreviation, to tell you a lot of stories. And this is the work of whom? Teacher, right? And you all are students. So you have to write in full length your answer. I don't understand what is FCFS. You have to write full what it is. FCFS is something else also. Shreyas Mishra, very good. Round robin and first come, first serve, CPU scheduling. Good. So in future, be aware that you all are the students, so you have to write the full answer. Don't talk in abbreviation because you have to think that someone in front of you is not aware about these abbreviation, that what is FCFS and what is RR. This may be RR, Institute of Technology and Management, right? Okay. That was on funny note. I am just telling you that you have to aware that you have your answer in full length so that someone who is asking can understand that you know each and every terminology of what you are studying. Okay. Priyam, can you tell me what is the working of FCFS, first come first serve, CPU scheduling algorithm, how FCFS works and what are the issues involved? Okay, issues will tell someone else. You just tell me the working of FCFS. Priyam, are you there? Can you speak? Priyam?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just explain in one or two line what how FCFS works.
So in FCFS system, algorithm system, the tasks which come first to the operating system, first completes, then the other tasks in the queue completes after that. So.
Okay. Actually, you have to use the some terms that define your answer, like ready queue, like CPU control or CPU execution of the process, right? And you have to mention the data structure also through which you are going to implement that FCFS. Now refine your answer and speak again. Use these words in your answer and make it something looking like a BCS second year student is telling this answer, okay? So refine your answer and speak again, including all those things that I have told you. Yes, beta. Please refine your answer. Are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there.
Yes, please refine your answer.
Sir, it is a type of a scheduling in which a task comes to the operating system. Mm-hmm. Then this task is done by the operating system. Whenever this one task is completed, the other task waits in the ready queue for the completion of first task.
You are not on the right direction. Okay, someone else. Adarsh Kumar, are you there? Adarsh? Adarsh, can you explain how FCFS scheduling works? Adarsh?
Yes, sir. I'm
yes.
Here.
Can you explain?
Sir, FCFS is
You can speak in Hindi, sir, if you are comfortable in Hindi.
Sir, FCFS stands for first in, first serve.
Then.
Sir, operating system में जो पहला task आता है, sir, वो सर कौन सा पहले पहले
This is the thing I am telling you. You have to use the keywords like ready queue. You are telling me that when a process comes to the operating system, you have to be precise that which process comes to the in ready queue first, that will be allocated to the CPU for the execution, right? So this is the soul of FCFS. You have to use some keywords that actually in examination, when you are writing your answer in 2 to 3 pages, but when your examiner is checking copies, it looks for your keywords. If those keywords are there in your answer, then he will give you full marks or she will give you full marks. If you are writing something jalebi round and round and round, and your crux is not there, your keywords are not there, that you are defining FCFS or round robin or something else. If you are not talking about ready queue, you are not talking about on which data structure or which principle it is working, then it is not good. You will not get full marks, understand? So I am explaining once again how FCFS works. First come, first serve scheduling. This is the scheduling in which your scheduler will decide on the basis of which process come first into the ready queue for execution, right? And which process come first to the ready queue, it will be send it to the CPU for the execution, right? And on which principle it works, it comes, we use the data structure FIFO queue, that is first in, first out, and you can write FIFO as FOFI also, first out, first in. So this is the just 2 to 3 lines on which basis you can define how FCFS scheduling works. This is the simplest one. And we have discussed some issues related to FCFS. Let's see who will tell me. We have Shreyas Mishra. Can you tell me what is the issue in FCFS? Shreyas, are you there?
Sir, the issue in the... Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, the issues in the first come, first serve are that if the time interval of a job is very long, and after that the jobs are shorter in time, then the CPU, then the first job will be having a much number of time in execution, and the shorter jobs which have a less interval of time will be in the ready queue, and
they have to
and,
wait.
This is the issue wait. Which comes. They have to wait in the ready queue only, and their waiting time will be increasing. And we have to less the waiting time. It's the major issue in the first come first serve.
Cool. So very good. This is the high waiting time they are having, and sometimes there is a problem of starvation. Please note this term. Starvation. Please everyone, excuse me. Please everyone note this term, starvation. I am writing in the chat box also, starvation. Starvation, you know, in Hindi, what is the, you know what is the meaning of starvation? In Hindi, we call it bhuka marna, right? He is starving. So this is the situation arises in, and the effect is called what? Convoy effect, because a short bus time processes are waiting indefinitely, because that long bus time process is taking a lot of time of CPU, that these processes are just starving, means they are not able to have resources of the CPU. Okay, cool. FCFS is done now. Let's talk about round robin. Who will explain round robin? What is the principle of round robin CPU scheduling? Can we have Shrikant there? Shrikant, please unmute yourself and just in 2 to 3 lines explain what is round robin CPU scheduling. Then we will start today's topic. Come on, Shrikant, are you there? Shrikant, can we have Shrikant on the board? No, Shrikant is not responding. Let's, we have Yash Srivastav. Yash, are you there? Yash, beta, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Can we please explain your classmates what is round robin CPU scheduling?
Sir, round robin is amongst the one of the algorithms.
Beta, please speak a little bit louder. We are not able to listen you.
The round robin is one of the algorithms that we generally employ for the process and network scheduling in computer.
Your voice is too low. You can write in the chat box. We have Gaurav Tripathi. Gaurav, can you explain? Yes, you may please write in the chat box. Just one to two line. Gaurav?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, your voice is
sorry,
loud
sir,
and clear.
I don't know.
You don't know? Oh,
yes, sir.
Okay,
sorry,
no
sir.
Issue. You can study in the Google Classroom. We have provided the lecture notes. Can we have Ananya Pathak?
Okay, sir. Please.
Ananya Pathak, are you there? Ananya? Ananya, are you there? Ananya?
Yes,
beta. Yes. Round robin. Please explain in two to three lines only. Yes. What is round robin?
Round robin is a primitive process.
Very good. This is the keyword you are using.
It is a primitive process.
Primitive scheduling. Please call it primitive scheduling.
It work on the principle of scheduling. It work on context switching.
Mm-hmm. Go on. Go on. Mm-hmm. Carry on. Carry on. You are in the right direction. Carry on, Ananya. Abhishek.
Sir, only this much I know.
Okay, cool. You can mute yourself. Abhishek Singh has written, same time is allotted in circular order. Again, I am telling you, be specific with the keywords. The same time is allotted in circular order. Now you can make your answer very tempting with the use of some keywords like time slots, like time quantum. That same time quantum is allotted to all the processes in a circular manner. And round robin is just like a synonym of a circular order, right? In round robin activity, each and everywhere we are what doing in a circular manner, activities are going on. So you can, you know each and everything. Everyone is answering the questions in a proper manner, but the keywords are missing. So in next answer, whenever I ask any question, please be specific with the keywords. These keywords are the soul of your answer. Until and unless you are using these keywords like time quantum in the context of round robin technique, or you are not talking about ready queue. If you are talking about scheduling, then your answer will not up to the mark. Okay. Yash has written something. Once process is executed for given time period, it is primed and the other process executes. And again, you can define your answer very easily. Like once process is executed, someone or something like a Krishna Mrastogi. Each process is given some specific time slot known as quantum time. After that, each process is primed and moved back to the ready queue at the end of the existing processes. You can add this line also, that process will append in the last, in the ready queue. Understand? So this is how round robin works. Very good. So means everyone is studying at their end. I like it. Okay, let's start today's topic. Today's topic is shortest job first scheduling, in which we will study two type of scheduling. One is preemptive scheduling and second one is non-preemptive scheduling. So let's start. Very good. You students are learning. This is what I want, that you students respond in the class so that I can understand that we are on the same page. This is the spirit I need in the classroom, that we are all learning and going in the same path. Let's start. Shortest job first. This is the next CPU scheduling algorithm in the CPU. As the name suggests, this is shortest job first scheduling. Shortest job first. As we have seen in previous examples, that whichever the process which comes first, we are giving it to CPU for the execution, whether it is having a long bus time or a smaller bus time, we are not concerned about that. But here you can see that in your performance criteria, we have one thing like called throughput, right? Can anyone tell me what is the throughput? Please tell me what is the throughput. Throughput is the number of processes executed by the CPU in unit time. So we want to increase the throughput. Means if CPU is executing a number of processes in unit time, then its throughput will be high. So if suppose three students are coming to me for some task, one student just wants to say me hello, second student want my signature in its notebook, and third student wants to revise the CPU scheduling algorithm of round robin. Now, which student having a shortest job? Tell me. One who is just want to say hello to me, right? This is the shortest job. So which I will interact firstly, that person who is just selling me, saying me hello, right? And then I will go for whom that need a signature on his notebook. And then I will go for that longest job, because in this way I have tackle two students and then go for third. In this way, my throughput has increased. Suppose if I go in vice versa manner, suppose I have taken first student who is just want to revise all the CPU scheduling algorithm. Now I am going on and on and on. And those two students who are just waiting for signature and greet me, they have to wait a longer time. So my throughput will be very low, because in that unit time calculation, my job is completed for that longest job only. And if in vice versa manner, I have completed two jobs and working on the third. So let's see how shortest job first works. Associates with each process the length of the next CPU burst. Use these lengths to schedule the process with the shortest time. As the name suggests, shortest job first, it associated with the CPU burst time. We are having two schemes. First one is non-preemptive. As the name suggests, if you are choosing that shortest job which arrives on the given time, then you cannot preempt it if whether a new process with the shortest job come or not. So non-preemptive is one CPU given to the process, it cannot be preempted until completes its CPU burst. Have a scenario here. Suppose one student comes first who wants to get revised only FCFS scheduling to me, right? And I am explaining the concept of FCFS to that student. And then another student comes, it needs just a signature on his notebook. After that, once I am working on that student's problem, another student came and needs a signature. Now, I cannot preempt at that point, because I have chosen the only task which was in the ready queue at that moment, and I cannot preempt that until and unless I have completely revised that FCFS to that student. Only then I will go for that signature thing. So this is called non-preemptive. Once CPU given to the process, it cannot be preempted until completes its CPU burst. Another one is we are having preemptive. As you're aware that in preemptive, we can preempt a process and switch to the next shortest job. And then if you find another shortest job, we can switch on that. So what is preemptive? If a new process arrives with CPU burst length less than remaining time of current execution process, it will be preempted. This scheme is known as shortest remaining time first. What is the name of this preemptive SJF? Shortest remaining time first. In the examination, you can have this question like apply shortest remaining time first algorithm to solve this numerical, or you may be written as apply preemptive SJF scheduling to solve the problem. So be aware that you can have this question on two different manner, either preemptive SJF scheduling, either another one is shortest remaining time first. As you have seen here, that at that particular moment, which job is having the less CPU burst, we will choose that. As the example I told you that I am explaining the FCFS scheduling to that student one, and meantime after that student two comes and needs a signature. Then in that case, if it was a preemptive scheduling, then I will preempt that explaining part of FCFS to the student one and switch to student two and put a signature on its notebook, and then again preempt to the student one for solving and explaining its FCFS scheduling. So this is two type of schemes are there for SJF. First one is non-preemptive and second one is preemptive. As you have seen here that SJF is optimal in compared to other CPU scheduling you have learned till now. It gives maximum average waiting time. It gives, minimum average waiting time for a given set of process. How it will give you minimum average time? Because all the shortest burst CPU burst processes you are tackling first. That is why it gives minimum average time for a given set of processes. So let's have a numerical non-preemptive SJF scheduling. Today we will discuss only this non-preemptive SJF scheduling, and tomorrow we will go for preemptive SJF scheduling. So let's see. We are having a question. Like we are having four processes, P1, P2, P3 and P4. And here you can see arrival time is little different. As in previous questions, we have same arrival time, that is zero. Now we are having, you can think of unit time, anything like 2 seconds. Let's talk about 10 seconds. Assume that this is at 0 second, P1 arrives with the burst time 7. At after 2 seconds, P2 arrives in the ready queue with the burst time 4. And after 4 seconds, after 2 seconds, that is at the 4 unit time, P3 arrives with the burst time 1. And after 5 seconds, P4 arrives with the burst time 4. Now we have to do the shortage of first algorithm to implement on this to calculate all these four things: waiting time, average waiting time, turnaround time, and average turnaround time. So let's see at time zero. At time zero, how many processes are there in the ready queue? Come on, tell me. Who will tell me? I need one person to help me in this. May we have Ananya? Ananya, are you there?
One.
Okay, cool.
Yes, sir.
Just stay with me. So at P1, we are having, at time zero, we are having P1 only, right? So no other processes are there in the ready queue. So which process you will choose? Of course, only P1, right? So till time two, that is after 2 seconds, what is the remaining time of P1? 7 minus 2, that is 5, right? So at 2 seconds, how many processes are there in the ready queue? P1 and P2, right? Because at after 2 seconds, P2 arrives in the ready queue. Now, which one is having the less burst time? P1, remaining burst time is 5.
P2.
Very good. P2 is having burst time 4. So we will pick P2. But this is the case of preemption when we can preempt. But here, which scheduling algorithm we are using? We are using non-preemptive scheduling algorithm. So we cannot preempt. Understand? We cannot preempt. So this is a case I am telling you that if I am explaining FCFS scheduling to one student and another process, another student comes with signature only, then I cannot preempt. So let's see how to solve this type of question. Firstly, we have to draw this Gantt chart. If Gantt chart is you have drawn correctly, everything is easy. So let's see, at time zero, only P1 is there. So we have picked P1 and it is non-preemption. So from 0 to 7, what is there in the CPU? P1 is there. P1 will get executed. And then after 7 unit time, you can see all the processes are arrived in the ready queue. Because till 5 seconds, processes are coming in the ready queue, but you have used the 7 unit time, right? From 0 to 7, in that time, all these P2, P3 and P4 has arrived in the ready queue. So which process you will choose next? P1 has finished its execution and we are having P2, P3 and P4. Now tell me, which process is having the less burst time?
P3. Right?
So we have chosen P3 next. Now, one burst time has been given from 7 to 8. Cool. Now you can see here P2 and P4 is having the same burst time. Now which one to choose? As you know that which comes first in the ready queue? P2 comes first in the ready queue. So we will give the preference to P2. So P2, then P4. This is how Gantt chart is drawn. Are we good? Do you understand or shall I repeat? Please write in the chat box yes or no. Yes for you have understand, no for I have to repeat. Please write in the chat box. Okay, I got one no. Let's just revise once again. Okay, cool. I am explaining once again. This is non-preemptive SJF question in which what we have to do, we cannot preempt whether if we have started a process for execution, we cannot preempt it. So let's see here that we at arrival time zero, we are having only P1 in the ready queue. No P2, no P4, no P5 because it arrives at 2 seconds, 4 seconds and 5 seconds. And we are here arrival at time zero, only P1 was there in the ready queue. So we will choose which one? P1 for execution. So from 0 to 7, P1 gets its execution time, right? Now, till time 7 second, all other processes are arrived in the ready queue. Because till 5 second only, processes are coming in the ready queue, right? P2, P3, P4. Now, P1 has finished execution at 7 unit time, right? So after that, P2, P3 and P4 were there in the ready queue. As you can see, P2 has bus time 4, P3 bus time 1 and P4 bus time 4. Now we have to choose which is having the less bus time. So P3 is having the less bus time. We have chosen P3. Cool. Now we are having P2 and P4 both are having the same bus time. Now here we can say that both are having the same bus time. Why you are not choosing P4? Why P2? Then you can think of it as first come first serve here also. Which process come first in the ready queue will get the advantage in this case, in the case of tie. So P2 arrives first before P4. So P2 will be given sent to the CPU. So here you can see that 4 unit time are given to P2 for the CPU execution. Then in case P4 arrives in the last. So this is how non-preemptive SJF works. So let's calculate the waiting time. Can you tell me the waiting time of P1? Please write in the chat box, what is our waiting time of P1? Waiting time is the time a process is waiting in the ready queue. Very good. Krishna, P1 waiting time is 0. Because P1 arrives at time 0 and it is given to the CPU at time 0. What about P2? What about P2? Priyam is asking one question. Sir, what is use of 3 in the chart which is before 7? This is just for the scale beta. This is just for scale to explain that we are using a scale 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This is just for scale. Okay, so for P2, we are having 8. Beta, how 8? How 8? When it arrives P2 in the ready queue? It arrives at time 2, na? It arrives at time 2. And when it arrives at time 2 and when it given to the CPU at 8. So 8 minus 2, that is 6 unit time it is waiting in the ready queue. Understand? Here you can see that P2 has given the CPU at 8 unit time. But when it arrives in the ready queue, it arrives at 2 unit time. So 8 minus 2, that is 6. Now tell me the waiting time for P3. Four. Okay. How four? P3 given control at 7 and when it arrives is 4. So 7 minus 4 is 3. 7 minus 4 is 3. What about last one? P4. What about last one? P4. Very good. Very good. 7. 12. At 12 unit time, CPU control is given to P4 and when it arrives in the CPU ready queue at 5 unit time. Now you are very, very well aware that how we solve this type of question. So let's take the average. 6 plus 3 plus 7 is what? 16. And what is the average? 16 divided by 4, that is 4. This is the average waiting time we have calculated. So are we done? Are we all on the same page? Yes or no? Everyone is clear how to calculate the average waiting time? Okay, cool. So let's go for turnaround time. Now turnaround time is very easy. Turnaround time is the time of completion time minus arrival time. So calculate the turnaround time for P1. What is the turnaround time for P1? Come on, tell me. Turnaround time for P1. Krishnam, very good. At which time P1 finished its execution at 7? And when it arrives at 0. So 7 minus 0, 7. What about P2? P2 finished its execution at 12 unit time. And when it arrives at 2. So 12 minus 2, 10. Very good, Kushagra. Ananya, Firoz, Priyam, very good. So go for P3. Vaibhav, very good. Go for P3 now. 8 minus 4, that is 4. Very good, Shweta, Aditya, Abhishek, good. Now go for last one, P4. 16 minus how much? 5. Very good, 11. This is the answer for turnaround time and how to calculate the average. 7 plus 10 plus 4 plus 11, that is 32, and divide by number of processes. So we are having 8 unit time. Very good. So we are very clear with this non-preemptive scheduling. Let's have a question and see how many of you will solve this. This is your homework question. I will give you 1 minute to solve this. I need only average waiting time. Come on, do it very fast. Do it very fast. Solve this question. Give me only average waiting time. I need just average waiting time of this question, and rest of the things you can do later. What is the average waiting time? Come on, draw the Gantt chart and you will get the answer in fraction of seconds. Come on. Let's see who will come first. Come on, do it before me. And you students, please think that you have to write the unit time also. I am a teacher, I can write only numbers 8, 6, 11.5. You have to write the whole answer. Good, Krishnam. You are very quick learner. You have to write the unit time also. So let's see, what is the waiting time for P1? Come on. Waiting time for P1 is what? Zero. What about P2?
Zero.
P2, 8 minus what? 2, that is 6. Then P3, what? 13 minus 4, right? What about P4? What about P4? 19 minus 6. Are we good? So what will be the answer? 6 plus 9 plus 13 and divide by number of processes. Understand? Are we done? So what is our final answer? We are having different answer. 11.5, 9, 6, 7,
1. 7 unit.
7 unit time. How you have calculated? 0 plus 6 plus 9 plus 13. So what it is? 28, right? And divide by number of processes, that is 4. We are having 7, right? So the answer is 7. Okay. So solve all the turnaround time also. We will discuss preemptive scheduling in next class. Okay. Till please use your book and try to solve questions based upon the reasoning I have provided you. So I like that most of the students are learning with me. So this is the spirit I need in the classroom, that everyone is talking about learning and studying side by side. And this is called learning. We are not going to mug anything. We have to learn. We have to go for reasoning. What is the logic behind these things? So we are then and only can understand the knowledge to apply in our daily life. So bye-bye. See you in next class.